Thank you very much. We're going to make today a rather large journey. And so before you set out on the journey, it's always good to have a map. So I would like to, this is a map of Europe before 1914. And you see the German Reich, you see my native Netherlands, this is the Austro-Hungarian Empire right there, and Russia is right there. And what's interesting and what's going to be of some significance in my talk is that Auschwitz, the town of Oswiecim, or Auschwitz it's called, is right there at the point where the Russian Empire, the German Empire, and the Austro-Hungarian Empire touch. One of the major differences between the map of 1914 and, of course, the map 99 years later is that there's no independent state of Poland. However, there are many Poles. Poles living in this area, in Russia, Poles living in the eastern parts of Germany and in the Galician part of Austro-Hungary. So, in the late 19th century, when there was no Poland, no Polish state, the Polish state had been effectively divided in the late 19th century, the Polish nationalities, especially in Germany, were asserting themselves and they tried to become independent. And a story not that much different from what happened here in Ireland. The Germans in the East, the German government and the Prussian government got very nervous about this because the Poles were in the majority in the Eastern territories and they felt that if the Poles would be given their way, that in some way these territories would become part of an independent Polish state. And so here we have a book published in 1897. It says The Struggle for the Eastern Marches. It's a German book, and you see there the Prussian eagle chasing away the Polish eagle, and the background is a castle built by the Teutonic Knights near Gdansk today, the castle of Marienburg. And this was a very important issue for the Germans, this fear for the loss of the eastern territories, which were essential for the identity of Germany as a state. During the First World War, Germany occupied large parts of Russian Poland, established there a Polish autonomous state, not unlike the Free State established here in the 1920s. That is, a state without a foreign policy, but with autonomous internal administration in 1916. But then in 1918, when Germany was defeated on the Western Front, the Poles demanded more than free state status. They demanded a sovereign state. And the Germans who had fantasized, as you can see in this image, of a peace in the East, a commonwealth in the East, of the smaller East European nations like the Poles, right there, and the Lithuanians and the Estonians under German leadership, suddenly saw themselves confronted after November 1918 with what was quite literally a land grab. They saw that from the old Russian-Polish part, the Poles were now trying to grab the areas that had been inhabited by the Poles in the German Reich, most specifically the area around Poznan and towards the north, towards the city of Danzig or Gdansk. And indeed, these territories were included in the new Polish state in 1919. However, large German minorities were still living in these areas. And in some way, these Germans felt themselves in a state of exile in the new Polish Republic. We see here one of those German farmers looking longingly over what's now a new border river, the Nogat River, towards that same castle, the castle of Marienburg, that had remained in Germany. This created incredible resentment in Germany because the Poles had not participated in the First World War. They had not sacrificed their blood, and in some way they gained the spoils of peace. It was an undeserved victory. This book, the title is The Eastern Countries That Are Torn Away. And of course, already in this title, you see a program of reconquest. In the 1920s, Germany started to redefine itself as a country that had been shaped by a centuries-long engagement and struggle with the East. This is a map of Germany in around the year 1000, when Germany basically consisted of what was until 1989 West Germany, and of course the Netherlands and Flanders. And Germany had pushed to the east since the 10th century, a push to the east, a Drang nach Osten, as it was called, that had been initiated by the first king of the Germans, Henry I. And you see this push indicated by the big arrow. By 1250, Germany reached as far east as Kovno in Lithuania, in the north. Kovno is right there. And in the south, it reached as far east as Krakow. And of course, here, Austria, what's today Austria, was also part of this German area of settlement. So enormous areas had been added and colonized by Germans. Key in this conquest, especially in the north, had been a order of knights, which had been founded in the Holy Land to fight the Saracens, but after they ran out of Saracens to kill, had moved up to fight the only remaining pagan nation in Europe, the Lithuanians. And they basically had settled at castle we saw before was their headquarters. This was the Teutonic Order, and this is a cover of a book published in 1939, the Teutonic Order, which by that time had become a source of inspiration for, amongst others, the SS. They built these castles in Poland. This is where today in Poland, the castle of Marienwerder, as it has its German name, by the way. If you wonder what this tower is, this is actually the toilet building, you know, at a safe distance from the main castle. Germans always have had a somewhat anal relationship, I think, to parts where we have a little bit more relaxed with. But in any case, these castles were described in the 1920s again as pieces of German culture that were in exile, that were in exile in Poland. The Poles really didn't deserve such beauty. The settlement of the Teutonic Order always took more or less the same pattern. A castle was created, as you see in this reconstruction drawing, and then a city was established at its base with a central marketplace and a market hall and town hall, around which then the merchants established their houses. And these cities all were ruled by German law. They might sometimes have been still in territories that were nominally under the lordship of a Polish duke, but all of these Germans who settled in these areas were not living under Polish law, they were living under German law. However, the story of this eastward kind of expansion of Germany was also a story that had run into trouble from time to time. There is always this idea that Germany was really also a kind of defensive bulwark against the destruction that came from the east, from the steppes. The Mongols in the 13th century, the Huns, the Slavs, the Magyars, all trying to go to the west, and the German knights and the German cities basically being this defensive kind of line separating civilization against barbarism. This again is a map from 1925 showing then a claim that came out of this history. We see here Germany. This is basically the red is the ethnic German territory, with then the Netherlands and Flanders as a kind of, you know, semi-German area added to it. Then here we see areas which were basically completely, utterly shaped by German civilization. That is Estonia, Latvia today, the Poznan area, which had been lost in 1918, and then Bohemia, Moravia, and then basically what is today the Slovenian Republic. And then, more to the east, an area with large German areas of settlement, for example, in Transylvania, the Saxonian Germans, but then also an area in which German was basically the language of civilization, of commerce, the language of law. And you see it as goes as far east as Stalingrad. So this map implied also a claim. The Germans had brought civilization as far as the River Volga, as far east as the River Volga, as far north as Petersburg, right there, and as far south as the Bulgarian-Romanian border. And in some way, Germany, in some way, deserved to have the fruits of that civilizatory activity. However, since 1918, of course, again, the balance had readjusted itself. The creation of a new Czechoslovak state, the new creation of the new Polish state, had created incredible pressures on that border. Basically, Silesia had been encircled. The Poles had pushed through towards the Baltic Sea, and there were these ideas that between France and Bohemia, they were able to basically quickly separate northern Germany from southern Germany, inclusive then also Austria. So Germany was in danger in the 1920s, and since Germany had been largely disarmed, of course, there was some justification for this paranoia. In addition, the Germans had a nervous breakdown because of the anticipated demographic collapse of the Germans compared to the fertility of the Poles and the Russian peoples. We see here 1810, more or less as many Germanic people as Slavs, as people, Roman people, they call them, around the Mediterranean, and the idea that in 1960, in some way, the Slavs would outnumber the Germans 100%. And of course, this kind of these images, these which were published in papers and so on, of course, shows there is a real problem. The Germans need to produce more children. The 1920s, many young idealist people decided that something had to be done, particularly settlement in the east, to increase the population in the east. It was an agricultural area in the 1920s, like today, of course, having generally a population loss. The idea was that they had to go to the east, and an Ottoman society was created, which had many members, which became notorious in the 1940s. One of them, Heinrich Himmler, chief of the SS in the 1940s, another person, Rudolf Höss, who became the commander of Auschwitz. They all got to know each other in the society of kind of volunteer peasants who were going to resettle the eastern territories of the German Reich. So, 1930s, in the first years of the Nazi rule, it's a little bit kind of condescending. The discourse comes down because Germany needs to have peace on its eastern border. There's Pilsudski, the marshal in Poland. Hitler has a good relationship with Pilsudski, but in the late 1930s, this whole discourse basically is picked up again. Books appear again about the mission of Germany in the east. Here we have the border between Estonia and Russia. This is in Narva, the Hermannsfeste, and then the Ivangorod. And in this book, we have also a long interpretation about the meaning of the architecture of these two buildings. Hermannsfeste, the German building that stands proudly with the posture of a fighter, and Ivangorod, which basically is like a crawling insect. Yeah. So you get the idea of the racism implied in this art historical interpretation. This is the cover of a book from early 1939, and of course you already see here a political program. It says, the robbers state Poland, and of course it crosses out basically the Polish Western territories, the territories that had been taken from Germany in 1918. So, then the 1st of September 1939, the German army marches into Poland towards the east to meet the Russians on a line that basically both countries had agreed on in the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact concluded at the end of August of that year. And in some way, Germany gets back what it had lost in 1918 and takes considerably more. Immediately after that, all kinds of publicists get involved in basically trying to imagine what that future in these regained territories, as they are called, how that will look like. Here we have a book, a cover of a book, Der Deutschen Osten ruft, the German East is calling. And of course it's calling to professionals, to farmers. The idea is that this will be an area of settlement for Germans. Again, colonial expansion into Poland. The one thing this book does not actually discuss is what's going to happen to the local population. But you clearly see here the areas to be resettled, and of course implied is that the local population will magically disappear. Now, I teach architecture, and I come to this topic through the kind of door of architecture. Architects got very excited too. They had suddenly saw an opportunity to literally rebuild a whole country. So here we have plans that are being developed in late 1939, in 1940, by all kinds of major German organizations, like the German Labour Front, to basically create in Poland a Heimatlandschaft, a kind of German, a central German landscape, with small towns surrounded by villages, and the villages all consisting of a nucleus with kind of hamlets around it, creating a totally harmonious landscape in which the needs of a modern agriculture are met with the achievements of modern civilization. Radio, telephone, basically a civilized life in the countryside. Architects set about with enormous subventions of the German government to create models. This is, for example, a model of one of these agricultural villages to be created in the annexed Polish territories. And of course, it's a good thing for the architects to have all of that opportunity. It also means they don't have to go in the army. Maybe you know Hitler really loved architecture. He saw himself as the greatest architect who had ever lived. Was very personally involved in design of, for example, the restructuring of Berlin. And it was a good time to be an architect, and they had a very privileged position in Nazi Germany. Now, where were those people going to come from? One of the problems with the resettlement of these territories was that Hitler had decided that that they couldn't have normal Germans coming in from Berlin or Cologne or Munich to settle in these areas and take basically Polish properties, because the really worthy individuals were fighting in the army. And he didn't want civilians to take the booty while Germans were in the army. The only exception were ethnic Germans who lived in Eastern Europe in the areas that had been handed over to Stalin in the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. These Germans who had settled there in the Middle Ages and in the 17th and 18th centuries sometimes, and as part of the Ribbentrop-Molotov agreement, all these people were going to be evacuated towards Germany, because Hitler didn't want that Germans would live under communist rule. So basically, the idea was that the annexed territories are going to be settled by Germans from Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Eastern Poland, and then Bukovina, which is now Ukraine, and Bessarabia, which again, which today is Moldova. They were going to have first rights on the annexed territories. The man in charge of all of that was the former Ottoman leader Heinrich Himmler, who brought basically his SS organization, which was very much fired up by the ideals of racial regeneration, agriculture, and so on. The SS was going to be the organization that was going to organize the immigration of all of these Germans from Eastern Europe into the annexed territories. And we see here Heinrich Himmler to the right, on the border of Germany, on the partition border of Poland between the Soviet Union and Germany, welcoming a Soviet, formerly Soviet or Russian German, ethnic German, Heim ins Reich, back into the Reich. Now, as the SS was welcoming these Germans to come in, creating transit camps for them, giving them medical treatment if necessary, and so on, at the same time, the SS was preparing the ground in Poland for them. So the SS started to evacuate, or if we want to call it by a more proper name, deport the local populations to basically get houses and farms for these ethnic Germans. Mostly farms, because most of these ethnic Germans were peasants. Here we see SS men deporting Poles from the Posen area towards occupied Poland, properly the general government. Then, quite often the same day, the SS would bring the German families to these farms, and here we see two SS officers, you recognize them, in the SS uniform with the death hat, yeah, talking basically to two of these ethnic German peasants from the Soviet Union and handing them the property. They would get these properties as a freehold property. Problem was, of course, is that the Germans, of course, had their ideas about, you know, the Polish management, that these properties were really in a bad state of repair. So it was not only necessary to give them the farm, but also to help them to make it fit to kind of German standards, to start to make it fit. So here we have architecture student from the University of Berlin, the TU in Berlin, the Technical University, talking to a ethnic German woman with her child while Polish laborers are repairing a stable. But of course the idea was that ultimately these farms would be much more appropriate for German inhabitation. Heinrich Himmler, who also became an amateur architect at this time, created in the main office of the SS in Berlin a very large architectural office to read, basically to steer the redesign of these territories. And here he's discussing a farm to be built in these annexed territories with Rudolf Hess. By the way, this guy, Josef Umlauf, is one of the main architects and the draftsman of the plans we have seen before. He was the architectural genius behind the whole operation. So everywhere in the annexed territories, there were exhibitions to show what the future was going to be like. Every local governor, every mayor wanted to guess, of course, his investment. Germans had taken over towns and villages and so on, and everyone wanted to see their village, their town, to be reconstructed. This is a model of a village to be built in the province of Upper Silesia. You see the map right there, around Katowice and Gliwice in Poland today. And this village actually is a village that was going to be built around 5 miles from a little town called Auschwitz. So when in early 1940, the Germans were thinking about Auschwitz, they were not thinking about the camp. They were thinking about rebuilding Poland. And here you see actually the governor of the area, Fritz Bracht, with the chief designer of the SS, discussing this model of this village. Konrad Meyer is his name, had a very successful career after the war. So, we're now going to focus then on this particular area. This is Upper Silesia. This is where Bracht was the governor, and you see that from Bukovina, Chernowitz area, 97,000 Germans were going to be brought to this area. The idea was always that these communities were relocated as a whole. So Upper Silesia, or this part of Upper Silesia, was going to be new Chernowitz, new Bukovina. Now, the idea is you do not spread people around. You want to contain, in a kind of racial idea, of course, of healthy communities, you want to contain the original community in a new area. Here we have the German Minister of Finance, Schwerin von Kosig, visiting the men from Bukovina and Chernowitz, the Germans, together with Fritz Bracht, the governor of the area, in a transit camp in this province. Behind him you see a man named Fritz Arlt. Fritz Arlt is the SS captain who basically is in charge of the local operation in the area. Fritz Arlt is the SS civilian administrator of resettlement in the Auschwitz area. Fritz Arlt basically decided of where people would go. He made the decision of which cities, which villages would be first selected for ethnic cleansing. The decision, this is one page of a report he wrote, and the decision was made on the basis of a number of criteria. One criterion was, and this is this area of Eastern Upper Silesia, where these people from Chernowitz were going to be, is the quality of soil. This was the best soil right there, second-rate soil, third-rate soil, and then the worst soil. And of course, you're first going to kick out farmers from farms with the best soil, which means that you're really looking at this area. Then, of course, you want, when you kick out farmers, when you kick out people, you want to be sure that these are racially undesirable people, real Poles. You do not want people who have possibly German blood, because it was a border area and there had been a lot of blood mixing. So black area are all real Poles. So basically now we have the area with the best soil with the area with the undesirable population. And then put on top of that was another criterion of only wanting to throw out a pure agricultural population because you need farms. The result of that was a map. This is the first map, and you see that most of the settlement is taking place in this area, in the southeastern corner of Upper Silesia. And this basically shows where farms are established, and this is the town of Auschwitz. So you see that in 1940, Auschwitz became the focus of an immigration of Germans. When the Germans were thinking about Auschwitz, they were that was their field of association. So where's Auschwitz? What's Auschwitz? When I talked about the three empires meeting each other, this was the border between Austria-Hungary and Germany. This was the border between Austria-Hungary and Russia. So this is Russia right there. This is Germany right there. And this is Austria-Hungary right there. And Auschwitz is right there. So you see, it's right on the border. And it had been a border town for centuries. Now, border towns, of course, are by definition very interesting. Because mostly there's trouble in border towns, and there's also opportunity. And Auschwitz was, in fact, an interesting border town. So, this is the river Vistula, which ends up, you know, near Gdansk into the Baltic Sea, goes through Warsaw and Krakow. And what you see in this map already, which is very important, enormous amount of rivers. Now, Upper Silesia, the area to which Auschwitz belongs, is a watershed. A watershed is an area where there's not much water, because the water sheds away from it. However, around Auschwitz, you see an enormous amount of water. All these little rivers and rivers coming from the Carpathian Mountains down into the Vistula. The Vistula becomes quite big there. And this is an important piece for the second part of my talk. So here we have the river Vistula just before it reaches the town of Auschwitz. This photo is taken 500 meters, so 500 yards, from the Birkenau death camp. It's quite a pretty countryside, by the way. This, then, is the medieval town of Auschwitz. In my reconstruction, and you can see, you can compare it to the earlier one. You see, there's a castle there. It's not a Teutonic castle, but it is a castle of a local Polish lord who basically is agreed for the Germans to settle here. But you see the pattern. There's a marketplace. There's a town hall. There are the houses of the German merchants, and very important, a bridge over the Zola River. And the bridge is a toll bridge, so that's one of the sources of the city's wealth at the time. Now, the city had been established by Germans, but during the Black Death of 1349 and following, the Germans had died out in Germany, and Germans had gone back to Germany. And basically, Poles and Jews had taken their place. So by the 15th century, Oswiecim, or Auschwitz, originally the name was Auschwitz, a German name, but now became Polonized, became a center of Hasidic Judaism. And Jews built a big synagogue in the town. If you know something about Hasidim, the Hasidic tradition, it comes from Eastern Poland, 18th century movement, but Oswiecim was the westernmost town of that movement. Of course, for Nazis, the idea of Germans creating a town, then losing the town to Jews, is the same as a nightmare. Here we have a picture of some Jewish kids from the 1930s from the Oswiecim Jewish Sports Club. In the 1930s, Oswiecim was a Jewish town. The Poles lived around it. The Jews lived in the town. The Poles were the peasants, the Jews were the shopkeepers, the small industrialists, and so on. The town was very well known for a distillery, the Haberfeld distillery, which was a very famous in Central Europe from the 1850s onwards. The castle still stood, and it still stands. Here we see the back of the castle. It's a picture from around 1900. Here we have the marketplace, which is at the back, the Catholic Church. Again, a picture from the 1920s. You see, it's a small town, mid-sized town, around 15,000 people at the time. Here we have a map. This is a map from around 1900. We see the town center of Oswiecim. We see the river right there. We see another river right there. And very importantly here, we see a railway line with a big station and another railway line. This is the railway line going to Berlin, railway line going to Vienna, and going to Krakow and to Lwów, Lemberg, the capital of eastern part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Oswiecim had been an important railway exchange point at the border in the Austrian railway system with a connection to the German railway system as early as 1850. Here we have then the station of Oswiecim around 1900. And it is, of course, that railway connection in Oswiecim that becomes important again later in our story. Now, this is a picture from 1940. And here we have the castle, we have the Zola River, there's the town right there. And here we have Auschwitz OS, Oberschlesien, Zola Brücke mit dem alten Piastenburg in German. This is a German postcard created after the conquest of Oswiecim, the renaming of Oswiecim to its old German name, Auschwitz again. And the Germans are now there to restore the German history that had been interrupted by the arrival of Poles and Jews. So here we see the marketplace again, and on the marketplace now we have again German inscription, Eisenhandlung, iron business, basically hardware store. So what happened to the Jewish population? This was a Jewish town. And so when the Germans marched in, we have here pictures of the local Jewish population in the 1920s and 30s. Of course, they were not very confident about the future. Immediately after the arrival of Germans, they began to pull down the main synagogue. Started with a fire, and ultimately, after the establishment of a concentration camp, the final ruins were removed by concentration camp labor. Polish concentration camp prisoners. One of the very few photos, by the way, where we see prisoners at work. Normally they were not photographed, but they did this outside of the camp. And the local Jewish population was deported from Auschwitz to Sosnowice, only to be brought back 3 years later to be killed in the camp. Now, generally, in their ethnic cleansing policy, the Germans had a very simple principle. We will bring Germans in and we'll take Poles, inclusive Jews, Poles out. We'll deport them into occupied Poland. The problem with Auschwitz was that it was very close to a big industrial area, major factories and steel plants, and the workers there were skilled workers, skilled craftsmen. And they could not simply be replaced by ethnic Germans, peasants from Bukovina. So instead of basically running the area by a means of deportation policies, getting rid of people you can't deal with, they had to terrorize the local population, which could not be deported. So how do you do that? Germans had, of course, developed since 1933 a very good way to terrorize and terrify a population, to create concentration camps. Dachau concentration camp created near Munich to keep the population of southern Germany under control, Sachsenhausen near Berlin, the population of northern Germany, and Buchenwald near Weimar to control the population of central Germany. Just built a concentration camp, and the presence of the camp as a kind of fleet in being, in naval terms, is enough to keep the local population under control. So, in the industrial area of Upper Silesia, Himmler decided that he could not deport the local population because their skills were too important in the armament industry, was looking on maps where he could create a concentration camp, and then he discovered the suburb of Zaseling, close to the railway station of Oświęcim. In Zaseling, there was a military base of the Polish army that had been, of course, empty since the defeat of the Polish army in 1939 and was available for use. Here we have some Polish soldiers. It was being administered by the German army, but the SS then negotiated a lease with the German army, and here we have basically one of the documents that were included in the lease agreement, and here we have the part of the camp that was now going to be made into a concentration camp. He found an old buddy from the Artemen Society, Rudolf Huss, who was Lagerführer. He was second in command of Sachsenhausen, brought him to Auschwitz, and Huss basically was going to make a concentration camp out of this military base. Very simple, you basically fence it in. So he also got an architect, August Schlachter. They draw the posts for the barbed wire, erect it, and to the left we have now a concentration camp. The old Polish barracks surrounded by a double barbed wire fence with a so-called neutral zone in the center. If you enter that, you will be shot. Then guard towers around the perimeter, as all good things, came into large, medium, and small. Dog kennels for the dogs that were going to patrol the perimeter. You see here the dog right there. Everything was being designed. A camp prison, and in this drawing, I'm sorry that I can't show detail, I just want to focus on this one. I'm showing an interpretation in an axometric drawing in the next one. These are standing cells. The standing cells in which prisoners were four. Prisoners would be put there in the standing cell without any supply of fresh air. 1 meter by 1 meter, so a little bit over 3 foot by 3 foot. Four prisoners there overnight. Mostly two or three died overnight. Again, drawn by an architect. A crematorium, because mortality was going to be high. So the old ammunition depot of the camp was going to be rebuilt into a crematorium with three double muffle ovens, which had a total daily cremation capacity of 340 corpses per day. There's no civilian crematorium in the world that comes close to it. Largest civilian crematorium in the world has an incineration capacity of 12 corpses per day. So already you start imagining, you see this technology as it being applied to this little concentration camp, which was designed for 12,000 inmates, that in less than 40 days, in 1 month, they were able to burn the corpses of all the inmates. So they were planning for a high mortality here. Now, the ovens were going to be supplied. There was a kind of competition, but the firm that basically got the contract was Topf & Zong from Erfurt, which had developed its business on the basis of Malzdarren, that is basically it is equipment for beer brewing, but it had branched out into the cremation business, and it had cornered the market because their ovens were very cheap to run. More expensive to make, but very cheap to run. Very low fuel use. A little bit like today, you know, the price of cremation ovens in some way. And of course, in a time of war, when fuel is very scarce, that's very good. These are then the ovens in Auschwitz. They were recycling the heat very well. Now, we left the story of these people from Bukovina. Here we have Himmler talking to them in 1941. And one of the things that Arlt realized, the man who was on the back, at the right of the picture, when the governor and the minister of finance were meeting them, is that by moving the people from Bukovina to the area around Auschwitz, they had come into a countryside where they were not used to the soil conditions, to the climate, and so on. They needed a lot of advice, they needed a lot of help to reestablish themselves as farmers in a completely different climatological situation. So, Himmler decided to help these farmers, that Hus, who was an amateur farmer himself, identified himself as a farmer, would establish around the concentration camp a experimental farm of 40 square kilometers, 15 square miles. And this was going to be the place where new agricultural techniques were going to be tried with these immigrants to see what was the best way for them to cope in the new condition. Here is the concentration camp. This is the corner. This is where the station is, just not in that area. But everything around it is taken in this new farming area of the concentration camp, which is now called the Zone of Interest, the Interessengebiet of the concentration camp Auschwitz, which we see there. It's a pretty area, a lot of fish ponds. All this was going to be developed according to the most modern agricultural principles. Barns were being created by inmates, designed, of course, by the camp architects. And greenhouses were built. This was going to be an agricultural utopia. However, then in the middle of 1940, Auschwitz suddenly also appears on a different map. It's a detail of the map. And here we have the whole map, published in a guide towards the economic development of Upper Silesia. And it talks about the creation of, this is the old area, the industrial area, to create a whole series of new towns, because the old industrial center is terribly unhealthy, 19th century, dirty. And the idea was to create new healthy towns around the perimeter of this area to basically improve the lot of the industrial population. And you see here that Auschwitz is one of them. It's actually the only one that is named. So now suddenly we do not have only an agricultural development in Auschwitz, but we have an industrial development, an architectural development, all to be financed by the largest corporation in Europe at the time, the IG Farben industry, which is basically the conglomerate of all of Germany's chemical industry. And IG Farben is interested in producing gasoline and rubber. They have basically procedures to do so out of coal, water, and lime. Now, one of the problems of producing that stuff in Upper Silesia is Upper Silesia is a watershed, so there was no water. But as I've said before, Auschwitz had a lot of water. So IG Farben was considering Auschwitz as a location for a synthetic rubber plant in October 1940. But there was also another town which had exactly the same conditions in the neighboring province. This was the town of Radwitz. And so now we get a competition between two towns which want to get an investment of 6 billion Reichsmark, which would be today the equivalent of 100 billion euros. Think about a small town of 10, 15,000 people, and having the prospect of such an investment in the middle of a war when really nothing is going on. And there are two towns now that basically have a chance to get this investment. So who gets involved? The mayor on each side, the local governor on each side, the Chamber of Commerce, you get the idea. But Auschwitz has one thing that Radwitz doesn't have. It has Heinrich Himmler. It has a concentration camp. It has a concentration camp in its suburb. And Heinrich Himmler decides that for him, for the SS, the best thing that can happen is if the investment goes to Auschwitz, because it means that it can finance his views for the future, his idea for a racial utopia. So he puts his weight behind the Auschwitz bid. Isaac Farben says, thank you very much, but we really prefer to go to Radwitz because Radwitz is a nice town and Auschwitz is a little dumpy Polish town. They literally say that. The accommodation in Auschwitz is not up to the standards for our German workers. So Himmler immediately hires an architect, Stoßberg, and while the negotiations are on, Stoßberg starts to draw the new beautiful Auschwitz. Here we have the old town right there, new suburbs on the station side, a suburb on the east side, and then the enormous plant to be built. There's highways passing through the town. And more architects join. And plan after plan is being produced just to convince IG Farben that Auschwitz is the place to be. So here we have the concentration camp, not filled in, the railway lines right there, the old town of Oswiecim, Auschwitz, with the marketplace, the castle right there, the River Zola, the new suburbs created there, and the beginning of the industrial estate. And it is on the basis of the promise of these plans that IG Farben, in the end, decides to move its investment to Auschwitz. You can reconstruct this almost day by day, these negotiations. So now the architect starts drawing the new design for the marketplace of Auschwitz. Of course, the church disappears. And he writes, the back of this card is actually a little text, and the text says, this is a New Year's card, and he sends this as a New Year's card, and the text says, you know, in the Middle Ages, we German came to Auschwitz, we established this German town as a bulwark against the barbarians in the East. In this year, 1941, it's by then, we do exactly, the Führer Adolf Hitler does exactly the same, as we are attacking Russia and pushing back the Bolshevist menace, we are recreating the old German town of Auschwitz. There was a clear sense of a historical parallel. Buildings, these are the party headquarters, which are now going to be designed for the town of Auschwitz in the kind of Hitler's favorite monumental style. And of course, the concentration camp is going to piggyback its whole operation on this enormous influx of money into the town. Concentration camps have always been very badly financed. For a long time, the SS got hardly any money from the state to run these camps. And suddenly, you have right next door, you have this enormous investment happening. So the first thing that Himmler does also in the camp is hire architects. These are all the architects that are appointed in the summer of 1941, after the contract is signed. The chief architect, Bischoff, his sidekick, the chief designer, Walter de Jaco, and then a very young, brilliant architect, with a Bauhaus diploma, but the best architecture school in Europe, Fritz Ertl. And those three people we will see again. Their design office, in this barrack, we see Bischoff here at work. I don't know exactly who this is, but you see them all heavily involved with planning the new Auschwitz. IG Farben is going to pay for it. The camp, originally this small camp, now suddenly the sky's the limit. This is the first of many plans of the expansion of the camp. You see whole new sections of the camp, an enormous new roll call place. By the way, this is where the railway are, and this is an SS quarter to be created. The next plan, be drawn by a student of mine. And it gets larger and larger. Enormous commandantur for the commandant himself. This is now the architect's office. You see, it becomes a whole compound. Now, to understand how big the Auschwitz of the imagination is in 1941, we have to look at a kind of compare and contrast exercise for a moment. This is Hans Kammler, the chief architect of the SS in Berlin. He's been hired as a very smart guy. He had made his career in the architectural office of the Air Force, but of course, after the Battle of Britain, the Air Force wasn't doing so well anymore, and the career of Hans Kammler in the Air Force had come to a kind of ceiling, hit the ceiling, but the SS took him over, and he was going to design the SS Empire. This is a standard issue entry to a concentration camp. Hans Kammler created a whole set of drawings. When you become a commandant of a concentration camp, you have to build a concentration camp somewhere in Russia, so you get a pack of drawings with you, and you can give it to the local architect, and they will make a concentration camp. This is the standard design for a gate. There's a gate and two barracks on each side. One barrack here, one barrack there, gate building in the middle. All standardized. So think, this is a relatively small building. This is the Auschwitz version of the same building. Yeah. Now we have two stories, there's a full attic. Instead of a two-story tower, we have, what is it, the sixth tower story. Everything in Auschwitz suddenly acquires a monumental scale, which was without any comparison in the rest of the concentration camp system. And that was, of course, because there was all of this money coming in from the outside, IG Farben money. By the way, it's an interesting drawing. When I found it, first didn't know what it was. It says special barrack, Sonderbarack. It's actually the house of prostitution. Probably the only building ever designed as a house of prostitution, because prostitutes were going to motivate the capos of the camp to work even harder than they did. Here we have detail, Tagesraum for the ladies, control, the guards, toilets for men. This is then bathroom for women, very unusual in a concentration camp, bathtubs for women. And then here we have a living room and then two workrooms on each side. Man, you're thinking, you know, these architects are drawing this out. I mean, It's not the absolute bottom in the history of my discipline, but it gets close to it. Now, in the Stammlager, the old army barracks, many had been added already there. These were the old army barracks, the Polish army barracks. Also now, we're starting to look at the crematorium, and number 12, a very large new crematorium that is being designed right next to it. Certainly, the Germans had no illusion about how lethal this camp was going to be. And the chief engineer of Topf, who had delivered already three ovens with two muffles with 340 person corpse incineration rate per day, was called back to Auschwitz to make a proposal the camp could not refuse. He worked with the architect, the chief designer, Deyako, for a weekend in October 1941. And they came up with a concept to create a crematorium with 15 ovens in it. And this crematorium would have an incineration capacity of 1,440 corpses per day. Immense destructive power in one crematorium. This is the first drawing by Deyako for this crematorium, a central incineration hall with five oven units, each with three ovens in there, trash incinerator, chimney, fuel supply, and so on. And here, autopsy rooms that are meant, that are, the law, German law, insists that you have autopsy rooms when you incinerate someone, and the SS, of course, doesn't do anything but according to the law. Now, a detail which I want you to look at for a moment, because it comes back at the next drawing, is this. This is the entry for the corpses. Right there. So the corpses go into that door, which is right there, and then there is a staircase and a slide, a corpse slide. And then in the basement, that corpse slide is right there, and then you have two large underground morgues. They're not sitting under the incineration room, but they stick to the outside. Enormous morgues to store corpses that are awaiting to be incinerated. This drawing is a second phase of the design. You see it becomes quite attractive, the elevation. This is the door that gives access to the corpse slide into the basement. a kind of gemütlicher German Heimatstil. This is not a cheap building. Very unusual, because at that time in Germany it's actually very difficult to get anything built. I just want you to look for a moment now at the detail of the basement. Here, the Korbsleit is right here. These are the basement, these are the foundations of the ovens. Korbsleit right here. So we basically have rotated 180 degrees the plan of the basement. And here we see one of the Korbsellers, but we see here a bureau. You see actually a desk there with two chairs in plan. Office. Then we see here Tresorraum, treasury room, safe, vault. And if you want to know what's being stored here, then you see in the next room, Goldarp. This could be Goldarbeiten, gold works, or Goldarbeiter, gold workers. Where does the gold come from? Dental gold, of course. So we see in this little detail of the basement already the concept of the exploitation of the corpses of those who die in the camp, being drawn in very professionally with a beautiful hand by the architect. This is a section of this drawing, the drawing ovens, beginning of the flue, chimney flue, forced air ventilation, and it goes up into the chimney, and then here we have the trash incinerator. Trash, human bodies, it's all the same to designers of this building. Now this is a section of one of these corpse cellars, these morgues, which stick out from the building. Morgue number one. And one of the things you see here already, because of course it smells very badly in these morgues, you see ventilation systems, Belüftung und Entlüftung, fresh air coming in, foul air being taken out. This becomes important later, this little detail. Now, in this plan of January 1942, these are the old buildings of the Polish military, the new buildings that have been built, the old crematorium and the new crematorium. You see the new crematorium sitting right next to the old crematorium. But a couple of months later, another plan is drawn, and both crematoria have disappeared. It's empty space there. You see here, by the way, the SS village. But no crematoria anymore. What happened to the crematoria? Empty. The mystery of the missing crematorium. It appears on another plan of another camp. This is the same crematorium, same plan, same dimensions, but it sits now on the corner of another plan. It's moved, at least on paper. This is the plan where in March 1942 the crematorium reappears in the corner. Very different kind of camp. It's the plan of the prisoner of war camp Auschwitz-Oberschlesien. Another camp which comes out of nothing, it appears. So, let's take a step back. Where does that camp first arise? You remember the creation of the big farm. Here we have the old Polish camp. But already on one of the earlier drawings for that farm area, we see a camp being drawn in on the other side of the railway line. It's near forest, little grove of trees called Birch Tree Forest. This is how the camp looks today. Birkenau. Birch area. So, let's go back to that original idea, to build a new city. Of course, very nice to build a city on paper, but there was money, but there was no labor force. The problem was that Himmler, from the very beginning, when IG Farben was talking to him, and Himmler said, don't worry, we'll build you a new city, IG Farben said, where are you getting the labor? German men are being drafted in the army. You're not going to be able to deliver on your promise. And Himmler said, I will find labor amongst POWs, Soviet POWs. And he signed immediately after that a deal with the army to get 100,000 Soviet POWs to Auschwitz. Soviet POWs who were going to be administered by the army. But he took them over for the SS. And they were going to be a slave force to build that new town. So after he'd made the deal, Ertl, the Bauhaus graduate, started drawing a Soviet POW camp. Lagerplan des, whatever, Kriegsgefangenenlagers or something like that, Auschwitz-Oberschlesien. This becomes then a totally rational plan, modernist plan, for a camp for 100,000 Soviet POWs. First version, drawn by this very young man, Fritz Ertl, and approved by his boss, Bischoff. We have the dates right here. This is Ertl. Man has very little experience. He builds this camp for 100,000 people. He draws it just up. Looks quite an innocent man. Second version of the same camp. Now there's an SS camp right there for the guards, and a railway line has been pulled into the camp. There's a gate. This is a reconstruction of it. Railway train coming from the main railway line here. You see the camp, a quarantine zone on one side where Russian POWs who are likely ill will be kept until they can be brought into the main labor camp on the other side. The original drawings for the entrance gate, you maybe recognize that, was extended on the other side. It is now the gate to Birkenau, the so-called gate of death. This is the original drawing. Now, design for Soviet POWs. In the German imagination, a Soviet POW, 1941, is an Untermensch, a subhuman. They're not protected by the Geneva Convention. They are seen again as embodiment of the hordes which had come from the East in the Middle Ages. This is actually in a publication on the Soviet POWs issued in 1942, and it starts out with an image of the Huns. The next page makes the link very clear. These are Soviet POWs. Now they are there again, the Huns, caricatures of human faces, nightmares that have become reality, a fist blow into the face of everything that's good. So when Ertl designs for these people, stables are even too bad, too good for them. These are actually the barracks he creates. 700 people, on average, they have the size of a coffin. They're going to be stored here like chickens in a contemporary kind of egg production facility. Three layers for 550 men. Just want you... The plan is the same. This is 2 by 2 meters. Are you doing feet or meters here in Ireland? Sorry? Both? Okay, 6 by 6 feet, 2 by 2 meters, yeah? On that, three people will have to sleep on each platform, three platforms above each other. Wooden platforms. This is how it looks like in 1945. Now, as Ertl is drawing this, a telegram comes in from Berlin. Instead of 100,000 POWs, expect 125,000. They don't have money or bricks to build more barracks. So what do you do? So here you see the original drawing, and it says it has a capacity of 550 men. Bischoff now, the chief architect, takes the drawing and makes a little calculation on the drawing. and basically now assumes that instead of three people on each platform, he puts four. And now the capacity increases magically from 550 to 744 men in each barrack. And he corrects the drawing. Objectively, this is a war crime. You see in these few little calculations a war crime, because soldiers are protected by the laws of war. Not often that architects commit war crimes that can be traced that easily. So that's the mentality the architects have. This is the result of it. This is hell. Think about on each level, four people. Nothing. Ill. Work to death. And now you start to understand why you need a very large crematorium. So, the camp gets larger and larger over a few weeks. And then suddenly, new kind of barracks are also installed, not only the brick ones, but also horse stables. They're easier to build. Horse stables from the army will just do. And they are actually built also. Photo from 1943 from the one of the guard towers. This is how they look today. Most of them don't exist anymore. That whole landscape in the back, because they were portable barracks. So they've been taken away after the war to house Poles who had been bombed out of their houses. This is how they look, 1945. 600-700 people in each stable. At this time, the Nazis are getting nervous also. That are so many communists and Jews amongst the POWs. This is a Soviet POW, and you see he's marked already as a Jew in the POW camp. And the Nazis in September 1941 start already to kill them in the camps itself. And of course, they are various concentration camps, they're competing with the best way to kill these Soviet Bolshevik Jews. Subhumans. So in the basement of the camp prison, block 11, we looked before at this little detail. In the basement, they create the first gassing facility. This corridor has barred gates there and there. And you can walk in between, you can descend the stair into this bit of the basement, put people behind the barred gates, right there. Put the Soviet Jewish prisoners behind it and introduce into the corridor Zyklon B, a gas that is developed for the killing of lice. And the Germans discovered that it works. So, we come back to the question. Why then suddenly is that crematorium appearing there? Is it just the fact that they expect high mortality of Soviet POWs, or is there also another reason? Because a month later, there are two of them and sitting at the end of the railway line. That crematorium starts walking through the camp from side to side, and as it does so, it doubles. First two and ultimately four. You see again these large morgues sticking out from the building itself. And ultimately, photo from 1944, arrival of a train, there's a crowd of people, and they're built there, one and the other, at the end of the railway line, and then two a little bit to the north of it, two others. These, of course, are Jewish deportees from Hungary. Now, when I talked about Jews until now, in the relationship to Oswiecim, Auschwitz, I talked about Jews being deported from Auschwitz, not brought to Auschwitz. The local Jewish population had been kicked out in 1940 to make the town ready, fit for Germans. In fact, throughout the 1930s, the Germans were not interested in having Jews in the concentration camps. Concentration camps were meant for Germans, to re-educate, quote-unquote, Germans. Jews had to disappear through emigration, German Jews. However, the problem was that no country wanted to have Jews. My country, Canada, my former country, the Netherlands, Ireland, none wanted to have Jews. And if you took Jews, we took Jews, then just put them in a camp, like the Dutch in Westerbork. This is a German caricature. Yeah, we are willing to give you your Jews, Adolf Hitler said, but none of you want to take them. If the Jews are so valuable to you, why don't you take them? You're hypocritical. That's what he told the Western governments. So, after the conquest of Poland, and then after the invasion of the Soviet Union in June 1941, the Germans, as a Verlegenheitslösung, as they so beautiful call, a solution out of embarrassment, started just shooting them. This is a photo from the Soviet Union. Creating, in 1942, death camps like Treblinka, which simply became killing factories. Trains arriving, and people who were brought in on the train being killed within 2-3 hours in gas chambers, and then their bodies buried in mass graves. If Jews were ever admitted to concentration camps, it was only as a temporary and a kind of unusual measure. This is a photo from the SS journal, the Schwarze Korps, from 1941, and this shows, as they say, nutzbringend verwandt. It means that they're made useful. These are Dutch Jews arrested in February 1941 during the so-called February strike in the Netherlands, and then brought to the concentration camp in Buchenwald. And there they were kind of, the Germans were quite open what they did with them, because they wanted to terrorize the local Jewish community and the Jewish council of not opposing measures, otherwise they would also go first to Buchenwald and ultimately to Mauthausen, where all of them were murdered within 2 months after arrival. And the Germans were quite happy to tell that to the Jews in the Netherlands. Terror. That was what concentration camps were useful for, but not for the mass deportation of Jews to them. The concentration camps were meant to be Jew-free, officially. That was policy. However, on the 6th of January 1942, Reichsmarschall Göring takes the unilateral decision, without consulting Heinrich Himmler, that Soviet POWs cannot be used anymore in the construction industry. They can only be used in the armament industry, if they are going to be used at all. And suddenly, Heinrich Himmler has a problem, because he has a contract to get 100,000 Soviet POWs. He only had gotten 10,000, and most of them were dead by the time that Göring issued his order. And they were going to work in the construction industry to make a German town in Auschwitz. So he can't do that anymore. I'm almost at the end of my story. So he looks for another labor force. And he has just, it's about to get control of all Jews in Europe. 14 days later is the Wannsee Conference. And 5 days after the Wannsee Conference, a telegram arrives in Auschwitz. And it tells the commandant, you are not going to get any Soviet POWs anymore. You will get Jews instead. However, to get Jews instead, like these Hungarian women, there's a problem in that. If a Soviet POW is a young man between 18 and 40 years old, and the Soviet drafting board said you can carry a rifle, then of course you can also carry a spade. But what about Jewish children? Old people. When you say you will get Jews instead, what they should have said, of course, is you will get Jews who can work, young men. So now the problem is to find those Jews who can work. And Kammler now comes back in the story. Himmler identifies the Jews of Slovakia as a replacement force for the Soviet POWs in Auschwitz. However, The Slovak government, when they're approached of, you know, we would like to get your Jews, they said, okay, we'll send you all your Jews. They said, no, the Germans said, we only want the Jews who can work. Only men and women between 18 years old and 30 years old. And the Slovaks said, okay, thank you very much, but what's going to happen to the kids and the old people? Who's going to take care of them? And the Germans said, you just solve that yourself. And the Slovak government says, we don't want to solve that. There's an impasse in the negotiation. And during this impasse, when basically the Slovak government has said, all you take all of them or you take none of them, Kammler travels to Auschwitz from Berlin, has a meeting in the architect office, and this drawing is produced. The decision is taken to move the crematorium. Construction hasn't started yet, but everything is ready for the construction, to this corner of the camp that originally was meant to be the POW camp for the Russians, which was now going to be the camp for the working Jews. So what is this decision that is taken? Right next to here, not on this drawing, is a little peasant cottage. And this peasant cottage, called the Little Red House, is transformed into a gas chamber. The architects go to this corner and they decide that this peasant cottage will be a gas chamber. And the next day, a telegram goes to Berlin, from Berlin to Bratislava, and basically Bratislava got to hear, we will take all the Jews. Don't worry. You pay us 500 Reichsmark per Jew, you can keep their property, and we will take all of them. And then, when the first transports start arriving in Auschwitz, selection is done, and those who cannot work are brought to this little house and killed. So, the Holocaust enters through the back door into Auschwitz, quite literally, to the back door. Auschwitz wasn't meant to be the center of the Holocaust. But once they've started killing Jews there, and as the policy gets more and more fixed in the summer of 1942, transports start going to Auschwitz. Himmler comes back, meets his architects, and now the crematoria are built, gas chambers are installed in the basements. And because of all of this preparation, which was really meant not to be involved as the Holocaust, within a year, Auschwitz has become the largest death factory in the world. With incineration capacity in 4 crematoria of more than 4,500 corpses per day. And every day, a train of 5,000 people arriving there. So it's a strange history. Starts with the best of intentions, utopian project, settlement of Germans, agricultural utopia, industrial, magnificent, modern factory. And within a year, we are facing hell. Thank you very much.